Уважаемые коллеги, у меня есть предложение начать.
Colleagues, let's begin. Let me introduce the panelists today. I'm sure that most of you know them and each of them, but I will still introduce them one by one. Immediately to my right is Sergei Shvetsov, who is deputy chairman of the Central Bank. He spent years with the Central Bank and has done really a lot to develop the banking regulatory system, the stock exchange, the post-trading market. He's a key person for the market, and it would be interesting to hear what he thinks about the Central Bank efforts to be made to bring the regulation in Russia even closer to international standards and to bring Russia closer to becoming an international service center. Olga Dergunova, another person who needs no introduction, I will say a few words about her. We've known each other for years, and she spent years in at VTB Bank. She knows everything about banking practices. So she's a key person whenever it comes to privatization. And this privatization is a hot topic for the future of the Russian market. The next key regulator is Dmitry Pankin. He's head of the Federal Financial Market Service. He used to be Minister of Finance, and he was very instrumental in addressing the international debt of the Russian Federation. So I'm looking forward to hearing from him what we expect from the market and what the regulator expects. Next to the regulator, further to my left is Alexander Afanasyev, representing the largest SRO. At least I hope it will be such. The Moscow Stock Exchange, which transformed quite substantially, merging with RTS, and it is now concentrating all the essential services. So he will tell us what needs to be done to make trading as comfortable as on London Stock Exchange. Dmitry Konov, chairman of the board and general director of Sibur. He spent several years at Sibur. He does strategic development. As an issuer, he will tell us why London, not Moscow, and what it takes to make Moscow better. Nadia Wells, capital research. We remember her from the previous forum because it was her who asked a question to President Putin about the future of VTB shares. And the immediate response was that the shares were bought back by the issuer. So now Konstantin Ryzhkov, member of the board of the Russian Foreign Direct Investment Foundation, a key player on today's investment market, and it's very important to know what this player will do and what they think about the Russian market. So we decided to discuss the stock markets because it is now undergoing transformation, which is not easy. Looking at the situation from the structure point of view, I would say that we've made some progress over the recent year because apart from uniting our structure, we also created a number of products, and we continue to do so. The central depository is now operational, and now we already see some impact of liberalization of correspondence relations between us and the European depositories, still there are issues that remain, such as volumes and the growth rates of stock market transactions. To what extent international investors are ready to come here? And most importantly, how comfortable it will be to operate on the market as the regulation changes, because in fact the regulator is the key figure on the stock market, and the future of it will depend, as well as the investors' comfort, will depend on the choices and actions of the regulator. Of course, the regulator does affect the Moscow Stock Exchange and its practices. And today we'll try to address this question. Is it possible to do the privatization as planned and budgeted? Like, and it's, we're talking about 500 or 600 billion rubles. This is as much as the budget revenue must be to cover the budgeted costs. Many people believe it's hardly achievable, but we know that Russia has achieved many goals that were unachievable, seem to be unachievable. I hope that privatization will go far enough to show the green light to foreign investors, so that we would not repeat the situation when we placed Rosneft and Sberbank shares on the Moscow Exchange, and we required four truckloads of documents to the place, which had to be translated and authorized. So I hope this documentation requirement would be as lean as from other exchanges. You are offered to vote. Voting will proceed with the help of devices that you were given at the entrance. The green button is the one you press to activate your gadget, this voting device. And you will see, as you look at it, there are a number of digits. In order to vote, you need to dial the sequential number of the answer, which is given as an option to a particular question. We here at the panel will be voting together with you. But our gadgets seem to be different from yours. Ours are even better. They are activated automatically. So you notice it's more advanced. So the first question, what it is that primarily develops the future of the Russian financial markets? Policy, structural reforms, investors, issuers, and others. Please choose the sequential number that corresponds to your version of the answer. What is the priority driver? So on the screen you see how you voted, and it seems that number one and number two, politics and structural reforms, are preferred as factors, and such a factor as issuers are not really believed to be of key importance. Maybe the idea behind this is that if proper policy and structural reforms are in place, they will eventually come here. Next question. Who will drive the future of the Russian financial market on the demand side? number one, international investors, number two, domestic investors, and number three, both. Please choose your answer. All right, I can see why people answered both, because in fact, for the market to operate properly and to be active, resident or non-resident status of the investor is not really relevant. Investor must be there, and that's it. The next question, more sophisticated. What is the key regulator catalyst for the further future development of the Russian financial market? Number one, domestic pension funds accessing the stock market. Number two, T+2 settlement. Number three, removal of DR limit on share capital. And number four, listing reforms. And number five, others. Please vote accordingly. So I hear applause from emotional ladies. I am one as well. So we, the regulators, and there are many regulators here, have their voice. So please bear in mind that this is what the market elite thinks. Next one. Should Russian companies still consider dual domestic and foreign listings? Do we need, as when we anticipate our placements, shall we think about both London and Moscow? Well, you know, multiple choice surveys, multiple choice for investors is always preferred. Moscow will be catching up with London, hopefully. We don't want Moscow to lag behind too much. Now we know what our audience, as well as panelists, think about the stock market development and preferred regulatory change. Now I what I suggest, I will now address questions to the panelists. I think that will be the most exciting part. Let's start with Sergei Shvetsov, because here he's really on the forefront of regulatory reform. The merger has not happened yet, but both the Central Bank and the Securities and Exchange Commission are probably thinking about how it will happen, and they have many questions. I have a number of them. So, Sergei, what do you think will change as the first priority on the regulatory side? What is your concern? What do you think is lacking or wrong in the regulation as it is? If you were the regulator, what would you change in the regulatory system? And what will be the impact on the market players as the regulation changes? What will be the benefit for the market community? No, thank you, Bella. First of all, I would like to thank Sberbank for this forum. I think this Sberbank with Troika Dialogue acquired a good name, and this forum is very important. And we hope that the Sberbank as brand will continue to develop and improve. It is true. It is true, we're living through difficult times. There are many things which are uncertain, and the G20 regulation harmonization is important. This is about Basel III requirements and OTC derivatives being placed under the clearing arrangements and regulation on top officials of stock exchanges. The process started for Russia to become the international financial center that was started in 2007. The working group was formed in 2008. A roadmap was rewritten several times, but over the period, some laws were adopted, like the clearing and the central depository law. There were a lot of debate around depository, because as the government passed the law, the registrars had to lose much of their income because they had to focus on depository business being monopolist for some shares rather than registration business. But this was a sacrifice which was inevitable. Now we have the central depository, and we are now beginning to capture benefits that will outweigh the costs. Also, the law on stock exchange activity was passed, putting those things in order. And the third process, which goes in parallel, is the development of a mega regulator. And the reason behind it is to bring the shadow banking system in harmony with the banking regulation. I don't mean to say that the regulation will be the same, but the extent to which the customers are protected in the shadow banking system must be the same as is provided by the banking regulation as such. This is important because the Russian stock market is a mixture between the proper banking system and the shadow banking system, and regulators are not intending to just leave only the banks on the market. So this process is as important as bringing Russian banks in line with Basel III requirement. The central bank is also undergoing changes. I am responsible for monitoring credit policy. In fact, if financial market does not exist, the central bank cannot implement its monetary policy and credit policy. So over the years, we were taking effort to reform the law and the financial market regulations. We introduced a lot of instruments, a lot of tools for fixed income operations. On Monday, a new project was launched on the three-party repo operations, which is important for the Russian market, which is lacking liquidity. Sometimes 70% of portfolios of Russian credit institutions are sold to the central bank, and the banks can no longer manage their portfolios, involuntarily becoming long-term investors, or they have to dispose of their portfolios. So for the market, it is a stress. So the third-party repo provides an important thing.
It does not freeze the portfolio, but becomes a game of reshuffling. You have only one place to reshuffle all the positions. So the repo approach allows to change the situation online. You just replace the securities that you don't need by the securities that you need to sell. This is a very important tool, and the central bank has several proposals in the pipeline. What about the monetary and credit policy? We need to improve the attractiveness of the long-term instruments for the banking system. We should transfer the derivatives market to the central counterparty, and this year we will launch this project. This is our intention. As for the mega regulator, we have prepared several projects. One is specifies the conditions for self-regulation of the involved entities. We need to understand that the state, the government, not in all cases makes the right choice of which way to go, and the role of banking community should be properly considered. And there is an institute of mediators between the government and the professional community. It's a self-regulating organization which fulfills three functions. First is a self-regulatory function when the participants accept obligations to restrict competition. Second is lobbying, and it's very important in the development of our legislation. Thus, we deliver our messages to the regulators. And the third is the cost efficiency matter when the self-regulatory organization received certain functions from the professional community, which are delegated to it. Thus, the professional community reduces its costs. And this is the way to organize things in the near future. Thus, we avoid long-term many years of negotiations with each other. So the new law that has been prepared by the Bank of Russia and is being discussed by the at the level of the draft, and we are discussing this in the investor community, and we try to retain these three functions that I have described to you. How can we do it? We will use the voices of the professional participants of the securities market. They will be able to help us materially. And the self-regulating reform will become a first step in the package of new initiatives for establishing a mega regulator. Secondly, we believe that the Russian market should radically revise the corporate governance. The code, which was approved by the Federal Securities Commission many years ago, has been already outdated. And we see that if we have high risks, then we go for high premium. And if we sell good assets to foreign participants for cheap, I cannot explain to the companies the reasons for them to go ahead with IPO and sell cheap. So we should provide a mechanism to lower the risks for the minority shareholders. We have a three-year project, and we have completed the first year of the project, and we have already developed a draft decision. It will become public in the near future, and it will become the first document in the package of regulatory documentation. It is not the time for revolutions now. The revolutionary changes we have made in the previous 2 years. There are small little things that are needed to be done to tune up our system to perfection. And the efficiency of our system will depend on this stage of tune up. So, currently, we are in a stage that we should not harm the development, the existing development, and we should be very cautious about tuning up the system in the remaining 2 or 3 years. This is my vision of how we should develop in the coming 3 years. Thank you very much, Sergei Anatolievich. It was very interesting to listen to your comments. And yesterday there was a question raised to the government, should we develop the corporate governance or not? So you just hit the target 100%. I think most of the community, most of the professionals working in this market do really support what you're saying. The corporate culture, the corporate behavior and corporate governance really require further development. The second key person who is a regulator in this market, and hopefully he will remain a regulator, is Dmitry Pankin. I would like to ask him an unusual question. Are you people ready for the reform? What is happening? What's going on with this, with your staff? Are your staff ready to undertake changes in the processes? The processes should be streamlined, transparent, and understandable. So what are you offering to the market? And what is the balance of interest between the financial market, stock market, and the banking market, between regulation of these two processes? So how do you view the laws like Glass-Steagall and similar laws that are building the walls between the risks of the investment banking sector and the stock market banker and retail investor? As Americans say, that the grandfathers and grandmothers who brought their market money to the market. So what do you think about all this, the scope of issues? Thank you, Bela Ilyinishna. You've raised so many questions that, but these all questions are about really the same thing. Are we really interested in hearing your answer? Yes. Whether the service, our service, is ready for the reforms? Are we ready to undertake serious changes? I would think I will reward your question. When you participate in the councils regarding the financial stability and the International Monetary Fund, when we discuss financial matters, it looks like we live in different worlds. How do we regulate the derivatives, the compulsory clearing with OTC instruments, calculation of all risks that are related to all these derivative instruments? And when I get back to our realities, when we have about 10,000 microfinance organizations, and they are not filing their reports yet, but the reports that they have already filed, we cannot physically process because there is no unified standard. Somebody quotes the numbers, the performance in billions of rubles, somebody is in kopecks. How to process, we do not know. We have reports on the insurance companies, the annual results, which are supplied to us in April, and we make certain prescriptions for the market by mid-year based on the financials they provide to us for the previous year. So we the key issues that we need to organize a basic accounting in the real-time mode in the non-banking market. The insurance company, the microfinance organizations, we need to understand the economic processes underway. And we need to have an opportunity to take regulatory measures in case we see there is a problem here or there. For instance, we see a problem in the insurance market. We see the problem, we sign an inquiry to the company, we receive a response, and then we issue an order, and there is a 30-day period for executing the order. So if we act like this, we are coming too late. we're coming when we are too late with our actions. We come to the company when it already doesn't exist. There is a lot of ex-clients of the company, and we have to somehow resolve this problem. This is the situation. So the first thing we need to do is to establish an accounting system and a system that will allow us to analyze these reports. And we have to figure out how to promptly react to the problem so that it will not take many years. For this, we need informatization. We need to make serious investments in the IT and infrastructure and make changes in the reporting. And we need well-trained staff. We have about 1,300 people in our service for about 9,000 microfinance organization and 200,000 issuers that we have in the country, and about 1,000 insurance companies, not to mention the brokers. So these are the key issues for us that I think we should answer first and foremost. The way we resolve all these problems will show us how we will be able to react to the processes in the market. The second question you raised is extremely important, the non-banking market. I would rather call it an investment banking market and the banking market. Market of commercial banks, the Glass-Steagall that you've referred to, and the efforts and the discussions in the United States and Europe are around whether should we revive Glass-Steagall and similar regulatory projects for separating the investment banking from the commercial banking. To my mind, this is quite a utopia, but they reflect the general trends of regulation. There is always a wave of strengthening the regulations, and then there is a period, a tidal wave of reduction of regulation, deregulation. Sometime later, we have another wave of regulation with the new options, as deregulation led to crisis and growth of disproportions. Then it is followed by a new wave of regulatory changes that slows down the business development, and the market participants see that it contradicts the economic logic. And then it is followed by another wave of deregulation. It has been like this, and it will be like this in the future. It will continue in the future. So I strongly believe that the division, separation, or regulatory barriers between the investment banking business and commercial banks are senseless. They are part of utopia. If a client wants a full range of products, the commercial bank products, the loans, accounting settlements, foreign exchange, and in parallel to this, the client needs services to attract long-term investments or M&A services or asset management services. It should be in one package. It can be divided by a legal entity, and they may be formally not affiliated, but inevitably, this set of services will be provided by one financial group. So I believe this approach is a utopia, and I think that no division of financial and banking services will be Now, why we have this wave in favor of division or separation? The crisis has demonstrated to us that for regulators, it's difficult to see the final risk being formed in the financial market. What are the risks included, embedded in the complex structured instruments? These we need to see. So the issue is not a separation of the investment banking from the commercial banking services, but the problem is that the market participants, the investors, should see clearly the risks. And the risk can be with the commercial credits, commercial loans. We must see what is the connection between the loans and the business attracted, which is attracting the loan. We also should see what is the structure of the derivatives product and what are the risks accompanying this product. So I think this is more important. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dmitry Vladimirovich. I hope that we will discuss this issue further with you. And now I give the floor to Olga Dergunova as a regulator. We all are interested in the time frame of privatization and whether it will be privatization wide scale or it will be a attraction of a strategic investor. What is the interest in the current assets that are being offered to the market? What will happen to VTB? So your opinion is extremely important for us, Olga Konstantinovna. Hello, colleagues. I will probably start with saying that privatization is not a particular transaction, which is of interest in its structure and volume of and its volume. Privatization is rather a process of changing the regulatory environment where the government acts as a shareholder and managing each and every of particular assets. Where the government is a shareholder or leaves this asset. So privatization consists of two parts. The first part is probably not too interesting to discuss. These are 2,500 of assets in the territory of Russian Federation, smaller enterprises where the government has 2% in a poultry farm somewhere in the Altai region. But nevertheless, these are the government assets. And they are in the plan, they were in the plan of privatization for year 11-12. Every year, the government sells about 500 to 600 projects out of this base. The way the assets are transferred from the government to the hands of the new owners creates an impression among the local investors regarding what the government wants to do in terms of developing the local market. When exiting the asset, the government should provide for the asset to continue its operation in its segment for the sake of the national economy.
And we seem to be forgetting about that class of assets, the 22,000 assets, which seem to focus on the largest ones, which are source of the most loud signal that the government does makes. So 2,500, which serve as signal to investors, and other privatization priorities, which are in the plan of the government. The list of assets is quite heterogeneous. There are assets such as public companies, Rosneft, for example, Transneft. There are also less known assets, which met controversial response, like Ural Vagon Zavod or VSK. But being in that list, is a signal for international investors about the government's intention. And the signal means that the government sees those assets as potential way to attract investors from Russia and elsewhere, and also that investors are needed as part of strategic alliance and as a source of expertise for operating those enterprises. So when the privatization plan is being put together, what makes this approach different? The fiscal side of the issue is not the priority. This is why the government is not setting a deadline like year X will be the target time. There are speaking ranges like 2014, 2017, etc. So this throughout this interval, the value of the company may change for the potential investors. So as we look at the totality of the group of assets that the government is offering to the world as privatization targets, so the approach is very simple. The government, as the key shareholder, must first decide what to do with the asset. If Uralvagonzavod is in the list, we as government need to say very clearly what class of investors is preferable and when. And then either the government will stay within the planned interval of time or will expand it even more. Now, as we set ourselves this question, and as we addressed one company after another, we realized that we need to start with road mapping, that is, planning our steps, starting from the description of assets and their current status, and also, on the other hand, we needed to set the target valuation. And the government, as the responsible shareholder, must each time decide whether to dispose of the asset entirely or to keep it and receive dividend as a shareholder and influence the environment and do the regulation. So working with each of the privatization targets in the top 30 list begins with specifying the strategy for this particular asset as the government decides it. The next step was the roadmap and the sequence of events. And what is important, there are some things that do not depend on the company itself. And there are many regulatory steps that must be made before the asset acquires the value that the government seeks and that the investors would prefer. The Russian railways is a good example. It's a unique asset, huge infrastructural monopoly. Whether privatization is relevant or not is still under debate. Expert community is still uncertain whether the government would rather dispose of the assets or should keep them. Up to 25% of shares could be sold to the benefit for the government in terms of valuation and manageability. And this idea becomes more and more acceptable to the community and to the company management. But in order to make this first step, first we need to amend the current law, which currently precludes privatization of the Russian railways as joint stock company. So as much as investors would like to see this asset in their portfolio, as much as the asset is ready for privatization in terms of its financials, still one step is lacking, and that is allowing privatization. Next, we look at the strategy, and there are many issues that arise, like cross-subsidization and other things which must be addressed through the synergy between the Ministry of Finance and regulators and other stakeholders. And this must be done before we can bring this particular deal, offer the particular deal to investors. So privatization is always a time period, a time interval, not a single point of time. It takes from 2 to 5 years to have the asset prepared for privatization. It's like IPO or on the corporate market. Privatization solutions or options should be chosen in the best interest of the asset, of the key shareholder, and the asset itself. And of course, having the company listed on the stock exchange is a strong signal for the market that the quality of the asset is good and that management is appropriate. This is why listing is seen as a way to attract investors to the market. But is it inevitable or mandatory for every asset, single asset? Not, of course, not. It is just a way to shift the risk from our hands to the hands of the investor. Still, the involvement of the regulator as key participant in the process must be, and the government must be, the locomotive of the process, being ready to bear the initial costs associated with imperfect infrastructure. On the other hand, the government will deliver the message of believing in the market as such and in the future of this asset. So for us, listing companies at the Moscow Stock Exchange is their priority. This is why we are interested in the maximum volume of transactions and investments activity. So as we discussed the placement of Alrosa shares for 2013, the definite solution was to go to the Moscow Stock Exchange. On the one hand, a $1 billion I made a slip of the tongue. Of course, it's not my sex, but Moscow Stock Exchange already. So $1 billion deal will be an important step forward. On the other hand, it will attract a new class of investors from all over the world who will come to the Moscow Stock Exchange. So we realize that some technical fine-tuning must be done at the stock exchange level, not any fundamental change. Of course, this fine-tuning is possible. Still, having assets placed, listed at the Moscow Stock Exchange is our priority. This will be a signal to Russian and international investors, and we are prepared to bear the costs involved. When choosing between local and international investors, it is important for big infrastructural monopoly to have local pension funds having access to the long-term investment so that pensioners would benefit from the growth of the company valuation. So when voting for the key driver and answering one of the questions, I voted for the pensions funds access as the key driver. If we succeed in doing so, the term structure of transactions and the liquidity will be certainly very different on both in both government and the commercial sector. We must help the market develop and provide infrastructure. So listing at the Moscow Stock Exchange is an imperative for each company, but the particular sequence of steps is determined by the extent to which the company is prepared to make them and to what extent the government is prepared to remain a shareholder. This year is not the best year in terms of international markets, so as for the targets for privatization, the VTB will have the placement and the secondary issue is anticipated. Alrosa, we will be choosing the structure of the transaction We hope we'll do that by the end of the year. This year we'll also see some improvements in the legislation to allow privatization of companies like the Russian railways. And of course, as we discuss the issue with the companies and the regulators, about the government interests in the energy sector, will determine some steps or concerning energy assets or other decisions that the government may make. You know, Olga described this step so beautifully that you need just to answer, will it make this step or not? I did not interrupt Olga, even though our time is short. So will you accept this step? Well, can we do otherwise? And as for the name of the stock exchange, the Moscow Stock Exchange, we could use any other name, but the most important thing is that the stock exchange would be good. Well, thank you. As for the question, the stock market environment is the key component of the financial market, and anything that happens there, be it private placements or privatization or just public investment or collective investment, there are several components here, and infrastructure is one of them. There's also such factor as investment climate, protection of investors, quality of the judicial system, and the sheer habit of operating on the market. Some markets which are ready for investors are more comfortable for investors. But the most important factor is growth potential. And for in exchange for this potential, investors can accept some risk because they understand that the system is imperfect. Well, the economy is now undergoing growth, and there are fat years when investors are coming in en masse, but then they are followed by lean years when all the deficiencies of infrastructure will come to the surface, and we need to avoid that. Let's take the example of the Moscow Stock Exchange. From the beginning of the crisis, financial crisis, maybe even before that, in the autumn of 2007, when American market was first distressed, there were five attempts between international stock exchanges to join, to merge. And the Moscow Stock Exchange was the only successful effort. It means that it's a very difficult process. But if you think about it, you remember that this was an event that preceded the establishment of the central depository, and this was a result of titanic effort, and this is a very important event. As the central depository came about, it allowed for centralization of clearing and post-trading services, and a number of new products and choices were offered, such as three-party services or the substitution of security, OTC clearing that will be completed this year. The T-plus process. Well, T-plus for us is a big reform of operations, practices, and risk management. All this is being done at a very fast pace, so fast that it seems that the market players are lagging behind, especially international market participants who are not fully informed. For example, in the past 4 months, the new IT platform on the spot market was introduced, the repo system for counterparties, the T-plus is already operational, and the volumes and share is growing day after day, approaching 8% of the total volume. The number of participants is about, or members is about 70. Last Monday, the ruble to RMB transactions platform started to operate fully. The first ETF will be issued in about 10 days from now. So there are many, many changes. And you know why in particular? Because international investors are revising, changing their risk appetites, not only to Russia, but other countries as well. So a new priority is quality of infrastructure. So now it's no longer enough for us to be as good as London or New York. We must be even better, and we need to improve things. Of course, there are good possibilities for that. So I'm calling on issuers to come to us and try. I know that the Moscow Stock Exchange is now in the top 10 list in terms of number of IPOs. But there was only one IPO of the Moscow Stock Exchange itself. Well, it's good that the IPO is big enough to match international peers. So this was our first trial step, and it succeeded. Please do the same. Other issuers may succeed after us. And it's not only infrastructure. We do everything we can to improve it. Sometimes we go even faster than market players would accept. It's everything about sovereign funds involvement and privatization. The stock market is not the only market that we can rely on. All interest-related products, interest-bearing products are developing. Despite the overall pessimism, the interest-bearing instruments we view with optimism. The bond trading has grown 50%. Repo and currency swaps are growing in volume, which used to be a source of liquidity. Interest swaps, interest risk swaps are now being used more and more. So again, I'm addressing the market players. Infrastructural opportunities are broadening. Please try them. International and Russian investors, individual, collective, institutional, all are welcome. If anything fails, we will fix it. Okay, it's a very targeted call and address, and we have among the panelists the one who can directly answer that. Tell us, Dmitry, what prompts issuers to choose London rather than Moscow for listing purposes, even though we are prepared?
I believe that...
I'm addressing Dmitry Kornov.
Thank you. Thank you. We were in a similar situation in India when we had to respond to the same name. So this is not the first occasion when we react to the name of Dmitry. I think I'm probably the only one who is not a part of the financial industry. I'm not a public company, and I'm oil and gas company represented here. So I will probably offer quite simplified, down-to-earth responses to your questions. So what an issuer of the company looks at when the company plans to enter the market? First of all, liquidity, transparent procedures for us. What is a stock market for us? it is a right balance between the interests of the investor and the professional participants of the stock market. Our opinion, simplified opinion, I emphasize itself, myself, the Russian stock market demonstrates a very strong disbalance in favor of the stock market participants and not in favor to the detriment of the investors. So we may consider different requirements to the reporting, whether we are transparent or not. It seems to me that formally, the formal situation is as such. We hear that the investors' rights are properly protected, and we all know that this is not so. We see that there are certain restrictions regarding placement of shares on a particular market here or there, and these restrictions, these ratios are fixed. This is as for the balance of interests of the issuer, investor, and the stock market participant. Should we compare Moscow and London? Is the second issue, Moscow or London? In our everyday operations, we understand that we should formulate the right goal and move to this goal in a proper way. So I think it is not proper to ask ourselves whether Moscow or London, because the global financial system has two levels. There is a level of regional markets and global markets. As of today, we should rather compare ourselves to other regional markets. So the Russian companies should be interested to be here first and foremost. When we reach a certain level in our development, then we will be interested to in getting a different level of liquidity, and then we will be compared to the participants of a different level of the market. So, and then the people will compare us to the peers, in our segment, in our sector. So I think it would be wrong to isolate us from making a search at a different level, but nevertheless, if we compare ourselves to other regional markets, maybe Turkey, Turkey is not a bad regional market. And there are certain things that exist here and don't exist there, and vice versa. And some things put us not in a favorable position compared to the Turkish companies. So, given certain conditions, we will play on both markets. But I think from the viewpoint of market development, we should remember that we should enter the market not because there are certain restrictions, but just because we must be interested in its proper development. And secondly, we will move to the other market, to the outside market, when our home market, our domestic market, is perfectly organized. Thank you. Please. So that's a wonderful issuer. Sibur is a great issuer. Whether we like it or not, there is an investor. There are investors, and they should like our issuers. They should like our infrastructure. And they should also, excuse me, like our regulators, and we will request two very well-known investors, Nadia Wells and Konstantin Ryshkov, in turn, to comment on what the Russian authorities should do in the short term perspective for the investors to come to the Russian market in comparison to the other BRIC countries? Where are the weak and strong points? First of all, I would like to thank you for the invitation to participate in the forum, but I'm here to explain the vision of the foreign investor, so I will continue in the English.
Market, I mean, it is a question, as you just discussed, of supply, demand, and infrastructure. And I think you can look at the evidence that we've seen in the last several years in the bond market to really see how quickly you can develop a much deeper investor base, both internationally and domestically, when the conditions are in place that are positive. So when you have good structure, good infrastructure, when you have interesting issuers, so Sibur is a great example of an issuer who has had huge success in issuing in the bond market, and you've seen the development of both the domestic and the international investor base increasing over the last several years, especially since the financial crisis when international debt became initially more difficult for Russian companies. And the equity market can, of course, follow. If we look at what those three areas need, infrastructure, our colleagues from the exchange have explained many, many times to the market the steps that they are taking, and we see that delivering. On the demand side, there are three pockets. So there's the international investors that are already able to invest in the Russian market, either through London, through international instruments, or through the domestic market. There's also a group of international investors who at this point cannot come into the domestic market, and that is what the infrastructure changes are trying hard to facilitate. And then there's this key question, which is bringing in domestic investors to the market, and that is absolutely critical, not just for liquidity, but also because that brings a domestic discipline to all the issues that the valuation discount panel discussed yesterday that concern all of us. It doesn't matter who as an investor in this market or as an issuer in this market. So liquidity is important. Investors bring that in higher volumes of trading. But we also need to see bigger issuance from companies. So the free floats in Russian companies are often very small. They're often very tightly held, and that does also restrict the development of the market. Another issue which is reflected clearly in the GDP construction in Russia is the dominance of resource companies in the companies that are issuers on the market today, and it will be great to see over time more of these smaller regional companies, as Mrs. Dagunova talked about, coming also to the market and giving more choice of sectors and more dynamism to the opportunities available on the market. And then there's also, of course, the question of consistency of delivery, both from issuers but also from infrastructure and government around their attitude to capital market. When we, you know, hear about state-owned enterprise dividend targets, for example, that they're stuck to, and that the long-term delivery is given and implementation is done of the plans that have been outlined for the capital market. In terms of catalysts for that, the mega regulator is one part of that, as we see that develop over the next couple of years. The infrastructure, as I said, I think that process is, you know, continuing. Local listings will be important to bring liquidity here, but these conditions that I just talked about are necessary first before that's going to be attractive for Russian issuers to be here. And then, of course, this question of the domestic pension fund. So a lot of work is being done on that, and it will be very important to see that delivered over the next year, to see domestic capital come into the market. If I look at international comparisons, a couple that I can think of are South Africa and Poland. So the South African market has a very long history of a very deep domestic investor base. Partly capital controls in that country have developed this. But what those domestic investors provide are, yes, liquidity, yes, a consistent presence of capital in that market, not the inflows and outflows that we sometimes see in Russia with risk aversion or risk on in the global markets. But they also bring discipline in terms of governance, discipline in terms of dividend requirements, capital management, and a positive process in terms of the development of new companies coming to the market. The other thing they also provide, though, these institutional investors in that market, is a strong funding base, both for the banks, where the banks can have up to 30% of their funding will be institutional, from, for example, insurance companies in that country, and the ability for a much bigger volume of corporate bond issuance in that market. And those will be very interesting and important funding mechanisms, long-term funding mechanisms for companies here, and to support the pension fund market in this country. In Poland, if I look at what they've done over the last several years in terms of their privatizations, they've had obviously a much smaller volume of issues to bring to market, but they've had a very deliberate process, very transparent process, and they've delivered on that process in terms of execution of bringing down state ownership of companies there in a way that has benefited the market, because they've been very strict about requirements of percentage of companies to be listed on the local market. And where there has been a minority buyout, they have required issuers to reissue. In the, for example, the banking sector, up to 25% has had to remain listed on the domestic market. And we've seen that market deepen. And we've seen it be an attractive place for smaller and medium-sized enterprises to list as well. So I think, you know, clearly the big key issue is bringing more domestic capital into this market. That will deliver returns. It's important for the country because of the demographic issues. The pension funds here need long-term returns to deliver as the demographic changes happen in Russia. And that's going to be a very important provision of return, both in terms of dividends and discipline around that, and in terms of the potential for capital appreciation over the long term to fund the pension funds in this country, which are going to be so necessary as the demographic issues develop into having so many more pensioners in the country needing to rely on that going forward. So that will bring an equality of interest between international investors, domestic investors, and a discipline and attractiveness to the market that I think will be very important for the development in Russia. Thank you.
У меня выключается, я этого не знала. Нам интересно, что по этому.
It keeps on turning on and off this microphone. I would like to hear Konstantin Ryshkov, a major investor in our market, because he really can influence the market, its condition, its prices. So we are, what are the near-term targets for the regulator, and what's the outlook for the market? Thank you. The Russian Direct Investment Fund, though its main focus is private companies, nevertheless, the development of the stock market and the existence of a well-functioning platform is probably a major factor for assessment of an investment, because we should think about the exiting the investment. It is important to make a proper investment, but it is also important to make a proper exit from the investment. And IPO is one of the examples of exiting. We believe in the measures that the Moscow Exchange undertakes in for the purpose of its development. We voted by, as we say, with rubles, being as one of the investors of the Moscow Exchange. We participated in its foundation. And the potential of growth of the Russian market and its further development is quite impressive. All the panelists have acknowledged the fact that what is needed and what is required for the market development. And I think I will only support what you've said. I would just say that we need to diversify the issuers. We should diversify from the oil and gas sector to other sectors. And we are investing in the money of sectors other than oil and gas, not non-commodity sectors. This is also a development of infrastructure, and infrastructure is extremely important for the issuers and the investors' decision to participate in operations of the exchange. And clients should be pivotal for any exchange. And the clients here will be the issuers who are entering the exchange and the investors who are buying from the exchange. What has been already done, I think, is a great success. Many things are unique. I think it's a tremendous breakthrough, and all we need to do is to confirm that all the changes will work for the benefit of the issuers and the investors. And the role of the regulator and the government in this case is very important, because the government can help to attract quality issuers within the framework of the privatization process, and also it may help a local investor to find way to the market. And here there is a chicken or egg. What's first? Whether there should be investors who come to the market, or the investors are waiting for the issuers to come to the market. And the regulator and the government can answer, can respond to all these challenges. They can bring to the Russian companies to the Russian market, and hence help the Russian money, including the pension funds, to participate in establishing liquidity in the market. So, I will repeat myself. We are probably one of the major companies who support the Moscow Exchange and the development of the stock market, and we will continue to help the interesting issuers enter the market. We will work with the co-investors, our partners, to explain to them the need to work in the Russian market. Thank you, Konstantin. We have discussed the situation and came to the conclusion that we have no time left, maybe 3-5 minutes, to answer your questions. No time. So, three questions briefly from the audience, and three answers, if there are any.
Вопросы и ответы очень короткие.
Be brief, please. Moscow Times, Irina Filatova. I have a question to Mr. Shvetsov, and I'm reading the news, where I read that Mr. Graf suggests that we should support the economy growth through the efforts of central bank. Any central bank promotes development of the national economy, and the Russian bank supports this sector by maintaining a proper level of inflation. So whether the goal should be for GDP growth of the level, well, there is constitution of the Russian Federation, and it specifies that the central bank should first of all provide the stability of the ruble. So the money has three functions: the measure of value, a settlement means, and the third function is accumulation, savings. Money should be money, and this is the purpose of the central bank. All the rest we do jointly with the government. Thank you. Another question, please. I think We've covered the topic in a very good detail, and I'm not surprised that there are no questions from the audience. We're in short of time, and I would like to thank all the panelists for the discussion. I think it was very interesting. Maybe some questions remain unanswered. And Sergey, you understand that we have a lot of questions to you. For instance, how Basel III will affect the banking system in Russia and how it will affect the stock market of Russia. And of course, we are interested in your tomorrow's actions. And who will be the investors to come to the Russian market to affect our current portfolios and the stock prices? We are interested in Dmitry's effort in his integration of one team into another. Shall we put our names in the waiting list for the future issue? And where the investors come from? Will they be domestic or foreign? I hope that the emphasis will be made in the for the benefit of the Russian exchange. Three of us are members of the board of directors of the Moscow exchange, and we'll do our best for all the Russian issuers and all the Russian investors to choose the Russian exchange. We wish you good portfolios. Thank you.